in a few slides. Okay, wait. What I want to do is I want to show you in a few slides what the state of research is here in Düsseldorf and what our approach is. The seminars we are doing here in Düsseldorf, if you look at them as a kind of a reaction vessel, you can say that we try to explore what happens if we try to bring together the process of Formfindung and the modeling language of COT and reaction networks. So what is happening if we are trying to bring together these two reactants? I start with a brief history of how it all came about. I'm professor for digital strategies at the Faculty of Design at the University for Applied Sciences in Düsseldorf, HSD, Hochschule Düsseldorf. And my background, what I did study is was media sciences and Catholic theology, so that you have an idea of my state of mind. And what might be also interesting is what we are doing in Düsseldorf at the Faculty of Design. We focus here not only on teaching design practices, but we are working also intensely on the development of design itself and on the understanding of what design is and what design means. And my main field of research, my personal field of research, is trying to model the operational logic of Formfindung, of the process of Formfindung. So I have the idea that that there is a hidden logic when we are doing artistic decisions, and the task is trying to get hold of this logic and trying to formalize it. I know this is a task which is we don't know if we will get there ever, but it is very interesting what is happening on the way. So Formfindung means finding the right form to fulfill a given task. So English translation might be form finding, but I like very much this German word Formfindung. When you think about, or when you want to know, or when I get asked, tell me what design is, then I would say that a designer is always in search of the right form. So finding the right form on all different areas, finding the right form of a letter, finding the right form of the chair. These are classical fields of design, of course, finding the right form of painting, finding the right form of making music, finding the right form of performing. Communication design, especially, and we are department of communication design, is what is the right form of communication? And here comes the semiosis in, where we had a short conversation yesterday with Peter Dittrich and his approach, which I find super inspiring. And of course, finding the form, finding the right form is a process. And it is a process, I assume, of artistic decision. So it's here the same with me as with Peter Dittrich yesterday. Of course, all this is speculative, and we have to try to prove if this is somehow true or not. And we try to prove it via the idea of difference, what I tried to point out yesterday. And so in 2019, I was invited by Katarina Petrovic to give a lecture on my topic, on my field of research at CLEA. And there, Francis Heiligen got me into contact with COT. Francis did say to me, well, this might be something that could be interesting for you. And Francis brought me together with Thomas Velos. It was great that Thomas did visit us in 2020, early 2020 here in Düsseldorf. And since then, we are trying to explore COT and the concept of reaction networks, and we do it in form of seminars. And our research is practice orientated, and we are operating here on a very, very basic level, because what we want to do is we want, first of all, to learn, and we want to understand COT and a reaction network, these modeling languages, and we want to explore the potential of these modeling languages as a tool for describing artistic decision processes. So this is the framing. In our research, what we did already, we identified three basic relations between the modeling language of reaction networks and the process of Formfindung. We can A, use the Formfindungsprozess to illustrate a reaction network, so to make it more understandable. And one example is the sonification of a reaction network for a better understanding of it. We can B, use reaction networks as a generative tool to foster the Formfindungsprozess. And we can use C, reaction networks to analyze and to describe the Formfindungsprozess itself. In the last two semesters, we spent most of the time exploring the fields of A and B. And the point of departure for this was an idea of Francis Heiligen in a meeting that we had with a bunch of people last year. Francis had the idea to try to sonify a reaction network. And the purpose was that the sonification might help to get a more intuitive understanding of such an abstract idea. And out of this, the research did start to grow, and the takeoff was a reaction network that was developed by Thomas and by Vincenzo De Florio, a little toy reaction network that you can see here, which consists out of five reactions. But what is what we learned here in Düsseldorf, which is very sophisticated in a mathematical way and very clever. And we did explore different pathways in Düsseldorf to try to accomplish the task of sonification. So this was our task, what we were doing last year in the summer semester and up to October this year. And the results we did presented in October, and the presentation was also recorded by Thomas. And if you are interested in this material, have a look at it. I'd show you just two examples. One example was by a BA student Alexander Cordes. He was also here yesterday. He was following online the workshop, and he came up with a solution. This is here you can see the audio tool with which he did it, and you can see the five reactions, R1, R1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And he had this great idea, which was kind of a breakthrough for us here in Düsseldorf. So how can we sonify this reaction network? What does the species mean? What does the reaction mean? So all these things we were discussing and we were trying out. And Alexander had this great idea, I would say, that each species of these three species has a special tempo, a special BPM number. And when he did play his audio solution, you could hear the different tempi, and then you could hear when one species was transformed into the other, and so on, because then the tempo of the different tempi, they became one, and they drifted out of each other again, and so on. So this was one solution. Another one was a piece of software that was written by MA student Robert Kopp and BA student Maya Lübke, a kind of reaction simulator, which was an audiovisual software. And they had another idea They sonified not the single species, but they did sonify the five reactions. So this reaction had a snare sound. This one had a kick drum, hi-hat, clap, and tom-tom. And you could see how they did react. And every time when these two species react in reaction one, you did hear a snare sound, and you could also see the reactions going on the computer screen. And one pathway was the pathway of performance we did take, and Thomas did mention it already yesterday. So there was BA student Natalie Malmann, she translated it into a dance performance, into a dance choreography. Here you see her Laban drawings of the five reactions. And also myself, I took this pathway of performance too. I did it together with my artistic partner. We tried to sonify this reaction network too. And we did this in a recording session in October in our studio in Bochum. So you see us here performing this this reaction network, and it is uploaded on YouTube. So if you give in our names, Verni and Jendrajko, performing reaction network number one, you get access to it, and it might be interesting to look at it. It was funded by by North Rhine-Westphalia, this video, so we could make it. And it was also great that Thomas was with us during the recording sessions. And at the end of the video, there is an explanation of the reaction network of Thomas and of our concept that I try to explain. So this might be interesting to have a look at it. Okay, so the basic conceptual decisions we took for the pathway of performance was, first of all, a general baseline for all our research that we are doing within these seminars. And this baseline goes, every analytical tool can be used as a generative tool. This is an idea which was fostered by Abraham Moles, who belonged to the circle around of Max Benzel in Stuttgart. And Moles was active in Strasbourg. So Max Benzel for me is also very important because of this whole semiotic kind of thing, because he was one of the first ones in Germany who really started to think deeply about semiotic processes and what they have to do with digitalization and with computer techniques and with programming. And one of his students is Frieder Nake. I don't know if you know him, you might know him. So he was one of the first artists who did computer art in the early 60s. And Frieder Nake and we have a close connection, and we have really these deep conversations about semiotics and digitalization and what does it mean. So the idea that you can use an analytical tool as a generative tool is for an artist, for a designer, super intriguing. And of course, we looked at reaction networks and COT as an analytical tool, and so it was clear to us we can use it as a generative tool, maybe. Okay, this the general baseline on all of our research approaches. And then we had three special decisions we took for trying to perform the reaction network by Thomas and by Vincenzo, trying to sonify it. So the first decision was, to understand an abstract reaction network, you have to perform it. So this is really something that I find super interesting. You can talk and think about abstract theoretical ideas, but if you try to make something out of it in a physical way, if you try to bring in your own physicality, If you try to perform it, then you get a different kind of understanding of it. So this is a super interesting thing. I think we touched it slightly also when Karl Zwosil was talking about the Contact movie. So our whole physicality, our whole emotions, all this kind of stuff gives us epistemic insight and is also important to understand something. So this was the first decision we did. The second decision we did was performing a given relational notation of a reaction network means to read it as a score. So this was our very, you could say, primitive idea that we look, that we, if we look at this reaction network notation that was done by Thomas and Vincenzo, we just look at it as if it is a score. And we read it from top down to bottom. We don't ask if you can start with this reaction, you can start with these reactions, you can start with these reactions. But we said no. We read it from top to bottom, this is connected with the third decision we did. We interpreted the species not as objects. This was maybe slightly the difference from our approach to the approach of Alexander. Alexander looked at the species as objects, as rhythmic objects who have the properties of a rhythm. And we were looking at the species, we interpreted them as a process, as instructions for certain actions. And out of this, we draw a score. And this is this, and you see it has the same structure. So if you look again here, reaction 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, with the species, and we did the same. You see here the species, and what we did was that each species now is an instruction for a certain operation that that we are doing, and they are operations, three operations in total, of course, because we have three species, and the one was condensation. The other was expanding in one direction. And the third thesis was expanding in the opposite direction of this direction. And you see here the letters J and W, and this means this is Jendrejko, this is Verni. So we distributed ourselves and attached ourselves to the operations we had to do. And so suddenly this reaction network turned into an action script, into a score, into a written instruction. Taking it from here to the basic concept of artificial chemistry, if the artificial chemistry is a triplet, SRA, of a set of species, a set of reactions, and the algorithm, how it was defined by Peter Dittrich in 2001, then what we have in our interpretation is a set of species. So each species is an instruction. And we have a set of reactions, which are the relations between the species. But what we don't have is an algorithm that defines the process, which means the time evolution. Thomas was already talking about it yesterday too. So we don't have this algorithm that defines the process, the time evolution, the dynamic behavior of the reactions. And we don't have this algorithm that specifies the duration, the speed, the running order of the single reactions. But we have to model a lot of artistic decisions when we perform this reaction network. So let's jump back. So if we perform this reaction network, we did perform it for the first time at a festival in Düsseldorf, which is the Digitale. We performed it on the 16th of October last year. So there are a lot more artistic decisions to be made than that are notated in this script. And here we have just a glimpse of what artistic decisions we have to do. So if we have the three species, which are the operations, so compressing, expanding in one direction and expanding in the opposite direction, the operations mean that we map values to certain parameters. We map values to sound parameters. And the parameters of the sound events are, these are the classic basic parameters for sound events, for single sound events. So we have to map values to volume of a sound event, to the sound color, to the pitch, to the tempo, to the duration. And we also have to decide for each sound event, is it a single event? So is it just one tone? Is it just one note? Or is it a compound of different notes? So this is one dimension we have to make decisions on. Another one, of course, is the dynamic properties of the operations and reactions themselves. So if I have an operation like compressing, I have to map the values to these parameters. But now the question is, how fast do I do it with one operation? How long do I do it? When do I start with this operation? When do I end with this operation? Do I do the operations one after another? This was a big question between Stefan and me. Are we doing these reactions? Are we doing them one after another? Or are we while we are transforming, while we are transforming it, or do we start to play parallel? So all these decisions we had to make our mind up about. So you have these questions for the single operations and also for the complete reaction. So you have to decide what is the duration of a reaction, let's say of reaction one, how fast it is, when does it start, when does it end, and is it a standalone reaction or is it running parallel to other reactions, and what is the sequence of these reactions? So this is another field where we have to take artistic decisions, and of course this field all of you know who are into artificial chemistries. A third dimension we have to make artistic decisions is so how many instruments I play, what kind of instruments I play. And when we start, for example, the operation of compressing, which instruments do I select for this? And if I have the instrument itself, which is a synthesizer, then what kind of functions do I select? So all these questions, are open questions where we have to take decisions. And here you see a graphic representation of one of my synthesizers, just to give you an impression. This is the Arp Odyssey synthesizer that I'm using, and you see all these different parts where you have to decide. These are the oscillators. This is the filter region. This is the region where you model the tone, color, and everything. The Hüllkurve, I don't know what the English word is at the moment. And so you have to decide, do I take this oscillator or do I take this, that oscillator? Do I mingle these two oscillators together? When I say I'm expanding now into one direction, what is the direction? Do I expand upwards the filter or do I expand it downwards? What is the starting configuration? And so on and so on and so on. And these were not only questions that Stefan and I had, but these were questions that we were discussing with all the students over the last year. And of course, in COT, you have the law of mass action kinetics. You can use it to define the dynamic behavior of the system. Plus, we also have learned that it is an ideal model, which does not take into account, for example, the properties of the reaction vessel. And so, and plus, you can use it only if you have tons of molecules. But here in our approach, it is only one decision. So it is only one molecule, or even maybe one atom, that we are talking about. And so these were, and still are, our questions. So what can we use instead? What can we use instead of mass action kinetics? And this is one of our main research questions. Okay, and some ideas we are experimenting currently with to find the right form of modeling the performance of a reaction network with a reaction network is, well, artistic freedom. So to conceive these results, the result Alex had, so to conceive this result, we said, well, what we have to do as a substitution, we have to use artistic freedom, because otherwise we don't get a step forward. So we started to use artistic freedom, but then we asked ourselves, okay, but can we find out what might be inspirations, ideas, etc., that influence our decisions, that influence our decisions, how we want the reactions to happen. And we start start empirical investigations, and we did try to identify external and internal, or we did say exogene and endogene forces that influence artistic decisions in a given situation. And so I find also the talk yesterday of Ivo Bissigniers, I found super interesting, because he was talking about pushed by external forces. And so this was our question: can we get hold of external and internal forces that push us to certain artistic decisions? And we did start to think about these influences as species. And here is just to give you an impression. So I worked with first semesters and asked them, could you get a task you have to fulfill, an artistic task, and can you write down all the influences that you get hold of while you are trying to solve this task, and distinguish it into exogene and endogene influences. And so this is by Lara Große-Overmann, just one of the visualizations they did. They did a lot of different visualizations. So this outer ring are external influences, and these here are internal influences. And we also did try to come up with kind of a measurement. So on a personal scale between 0 and 10, did it have a strong impact, or did it have a not so strong impact? And so we were experimenting, and we are still experimenting with this, and we try to find the right scales. So we are discussing, shall we do it 0 to 10, or is it better to do 0 to 5? Is it better to have uneven numbers or even numbers on the scale, and so on and so on? So this is another field where we are working on. So we are experimenting also with the introduction of what we call process configuration rules. And these are thought of as meta rules that conduct the process. So the time evolution of the system, the application, activation, and running order of the reaction. So can we find these these process configuration rules maybe, and can we define them? This is still an open process. We are not sure of. Thomas and I, we also did talk a lot about this, and it was during a meeting with Thomas that we came up with this notion of process configuration rules. And this is a very new idea. It's just 2 weeks old, but I think since this is a workshop, I throw everything we have on the table. Another idea was maybe instead of mass action kinetics, what about if we think of an intensity-driven reaction network, which means that some species have a higher intensity, and the species that has a higher intensity rules over other species which have lower intensity, or we can turn it around and we can say lower intensity maybe attracts higher intensity and so on. And we also have to explore more on this. And there was already a super interesting conversation with Sten Bundervoet and Diederik Erz, where Diederik was talking about lower energy attracts higher energy, and maybe this could be a way. I don't know. We are still exploring. Then an important distinction we started to think of more deeply was: shall we think spatial or shall we think non-spatial? This was also so a theme yesterday. And it was also a deep conversation I had with Thomas, because I suddenly understood that some concepts are thought of non-spatial. For example, like this great PhD defense by Dirk Bruns that I saw, I think if I got it right, this is these memes and meme plexus. This is more thought in a non-spatial way. And we also started to think about this. So first let's think spatial, and then thinking of the situation as a reaction vessel, which has properties, and these properties influence the behavior of the reaction network as external forces. But then also we started to think, what is happening when we are thinking non-spatial? And that we think of the situation as another species within a reaction. Yes, and last thing that we are thinking of is that we try to apply properties to the species, which is also different to the original COT concept. So that a species is a combination of different properties. So this is what we are working on. So as a momentary result, I just show it. It's not ready yet. It's just a sketch. It is by a BA student, Oleg Becker. He just finished it in our last session now in the winter semester. And we will keep working on this in the summer semester. So what we did then to get maybe more hold on these ideas, we did choose a very, very, on the first look, very simple situation: buying something in a supermarket. You go into a supermarket and now you buy something. And out of this, and so we really started to think about, well, this is a supermarket, and what could be now the process configuration rules? How is the setup of a supermarket? Where is the beef? Where is the bread? So the positioning within this space, how does this influence the reaction that can happen? Some actions can only happen in certain areas, et cetera, et cetera. We started to bring in emotions, what you can see here. And what we find also super intriguing that Oleg had this idea just to translate the formalism of reaction networks right into a diagrammatic form. And I think this is a very, very interesting approach. Natalie Malmann went into a similar direction. And yeah, we will. And then the question is now, can we think of this environment here as a spatial species, or what is if we look at this whole thing, what is happening here as another species that is influencing this, and what is if we copy this reaction network onto the reaction vessel, which is the supermarket, if we bring these layers, if we put them over each other, on top of each other. But all this is just spoken into pure speculation. I just want to show it to you because this is now the latest thing. And some new ideas. I was super inspired yesterday, thanks to the Granada workshop. The one thing was the talk of Stefan Peter. And when I saw these diagrams of infection and response, I thought maybe this might be also a good way. I didn't look at it that closely to this idea of infection and response, although Thomas and I, we did also had a deep conversation on this. It didn't infect me that much. It infected me yesterday. So I got this infection by this idea. And what does this might mean? And the other thing is, which was super inspiring, this concept of capacity of contingent mapping by Peter Dittrich. And yesterday night I was so inspired by this that I did a late night try to apply the contingent mapping concept to the performance situation of Stefan and me. So let me just jump back to the photo that you have the situation in front of your eyes. So this is Stefan here. This is his synthesizer setup. This is me. I have here my synthesizer setup. We have the score of the reaction network, and now we did start to play. And of course, now interactions did start to happen. And yesterday night, I did this sketch, and I thought, let me try to explain. And I don't know if I understood it right. And I really want to learn more about this whole approach because I found it so intriguing. So I had this idea that we can say that we have as domain and of as co-domain that we have here the acoustic signs of both performers, of me, performer J, and of performer W. So this is the set of acoustic signs. And here we have a set of acoustic signs, just my signs, that are responses to these acoustic signs. And here I am in the middle, the performer J, and I have now as a performer the capacity to change the mappings. Because if I have this set of possible acoustic signs, and now I can decide, do I map the acoustic sign from Stefan this, do I map it to here, or do I map it there? Also to look at so this whole idea of semiosis suddenly gave me yesterday this idea that this might be a very good framework maybe to describe the situation of Stefan and me. And so then changing the context and find an alternative context. And my question then was, I wrote this here, DJ two, DJ one, and DJ N. And DJ N means that I need rules how to change mappings. These are open questions I also put on the table. So rough ideas here is that the performer has the capacity to change the mapping. He is a decider, to use the word of Ivo. I guess Ivo came up yesterday with this word of decider. And what I need as a decider is a domain and a codomain. So I get these signals and I transform these signals into that signal. So I can really look at myself as an enzyme, like Peter Dietrich was talking about enzymes yesterday. I don't know. This is also just an idea, just a fantasy. So I need this domain and the codomain, which is, as I said, set of acoustic signs and potential responses. So this is already an intermingling of these two ideas of infection response and this approach. I need a set of mappings and I need a set of rules to change the mappings that I have at my hands. And so this seems to me that this could be a very, very good way to describe the performance situation of Stefan and me. I really, if it is possible, I really want to learn more about this whole approach that Peter Dietrich pointed out yesterday. And maybe it is possible that we could have contact and that I can learn more about it, because I think it's super interesting also on this semiotic level. We could also go deeper into. And all this is maybe also impossible. Francis was saying yesterday, and I agree totally, that a good model is a model that predicts what you want to know. But our leading question in Düsseldorf at the moment is not so much about prediction, but at the moment the question is, what is the best way to represent a design process in terms of a reaction network? So this is the overall idea under which we try to explore and to find ideas and to try out ideas and maybe find one day a solution. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Christian. Thank you everyone for your sharp ear, because the speakers are not the best, but we could still hear you, I think 98%. 98%.
Ah, okay.
Is a good estimate.
Shall I go back to...
Do you want to share something?
I just want to de-share my...
I will.
So that you can see me and that I can see you.
Yeah, please start the gallery view.
So yes.
I think you have to stop sharing yourself.
Yes.
There you go.
Yes, I did.
And then Karsten asks, put some content. So gallery view is this one, gallery view. Okay, open the biggest possible. And this is it. Okay. So we have time for a few questions. Please, Francis.
The one thing I liked in your presentation is the notion of a chemical organization. And if I would think in terms of a design process, I would see the process of the self-organization, where you have the reaction network, you start with some random species, and then it settles into the organization. And once the organization is there, I assume that there will be some kind of a repetitive structure of processes, which then can be seen as a kind of a design. So my original idea with the solidification was that you would have the musical piece, not so much the reaction network, but the emerging organization, and that the process of settling into the organization would be kind of like the intro, and then the organization itself would be the musical piece. And if the musical piece becomes too repetitive, then you can start perturbing it to make it go out of its attractor and from the basin back into the attractor, etc.
Yeah.
So have you thought in these terms?
No, not yet, because this, as I said in the beginning, we are operating on a very basic level first of all, to understand and to learn what this whole modeling language is about. And this step with attractors and basins, can you hear me? Is it?
Yes. Yeah, I was just checking.
Ah, okay.
But yeah, it's...
okay. And this thing of emergent phenomena. This is the next step we have to try out. But we are not there. We are not there at the moment. We are a level underneath.
May I compliment briefly, Christian? So yes. We started with the same aim, you say, and actually with Vincenzo, we did some kind of brave examples to go straight there. But then we discover there are so many subtleties to check on first without, like, not to go directly there. And then we kind of, this is what all this was open up after. So, yeah, it's an ongoing process and very nice because it brings a lot of new ideas. Do you have a question, Peter? Anybody else?
Yes. Just, can you hear me?
Yeah, yes.
Okay. So the question is, when you look, let's say, take the semiotic stuff, so the mapping, the arbitrary mapping, contingent mapping, so how much is also the audience that listens to the music also gives meaning to the music? So basically, how also, let's say, the audience enjoying the music, not enjoying the music, or what the audience think, also generates some semantics.
Yes.
Sound. So that should also be involved in the performance, right? So when you do it.
Yes, absolutely. This situation now was, it was Stefan and me in the studio, so it was just us, we were the audience, although Thomas was also there. So Thomas was there during the recordings, and so he was the audience, you can say. Yes. And of course, this is not taken into account, but this is a very important point.
Okay. Yeah. Just this interaction between the audience and music in quantum music, this is very essential.
Yeah.
Because in quantum music, you can have a coherent superposition of tones, and not everybody hears the same tone. So it may be that the audience, the people in the audience, hear very different compositions.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think this is always the case that people hear different compositions. It depends on the knowledge level of people. It depends on their experience. So this is this multiform. For example, Karl-Heinz Stockhausen was talking about, you know, taking into account all these semiotic questions too, so that you have that it is an open form. Every form is an open form. And is open to this whole idea is already there, and I think the approach of quantum music. I read your paper about it, which, and I find it super 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 interesting too. And I wonder if it would fit in to try this out within this research we are doing here. And I think that quantum music is a way to show it that you have different experiences that we have always, but that we are not aware of.
Okay, any more questions? Okay, I will finish this talk with you. Thank you again, Christian.
Thank you very much.
I would like to finish mentioning that this is also a very beautiful moment because this has ended the cycle of presentations of you, Peter, Francis, and me, and some others, which is this new group that we created in CLEA, the Center Leo Apostel. We have a group where Peter and Christian and I are like the, Francis is the head, like the representative at the group. But Christian, me, and Peter are like the representatives at the level of content for this topic called systemic modeling and applications. And this is why you might find this conference, in this workshop, people speaking about philosophy, quantum theory, artistic design, and like the mathematical formalizations of autopoiesis, or like all these things intermingled without a specific traditional purpose of we want to solve the whatever conjecture. We allow ourselves to open our mind to other types of perspectives that maybe question things from sides that in the traditional sense might be seen as uninteresting, but in the sense that we want to create here is like broader, open, maybe not always efficient, as efficient as, you know, optimization process, but always keeping the optimization of the never going too narrow in your thinking. That's what we want to optimize, not actually solving specific problems. Of course, we want to remain efficient enough to solve problems, but without compromising the mind openness. So this is the spirit. I switch the camera because now we have the talks of Fiona and, mm-hmm. and Simon. So please do not leave. I will just manage now to get the talks in the screen. Simon. Yeah, no, just will let them on, so no problem.
Pushing you over
the thing. And now when did you send the slides, Fion? Ah, here, just last night. Yeah. Got it. Yeah. Perfect. Okay, so I will just leave this kind of as big as possible here, and then here, and then here, and then here. Okay, so I'm very glad to introduce as well the students like of the conference, of the workshop. So these are Fionn and Simon. Both are master students working with Peter Dietrich, but in parallel working with us in the Templeton project from very recently. So their field of expertise is the chemical organization theory particularly, and they have dedicated to expand or to improve the methods and the tools that are used to analyze reaction networks. So Fionn will tell us about interfaces to represent, visualize, and analyze reaction networks. And Simon will explain us about a specific application of chemical reaction network in the field of knowledge in science, right? So, yeah. So, okay, thank you, John and Simon. And Phil, like, go for it, yes.
So, I'm John. I'm talking.
Sorry, is the camera working? Just to check. This one? Yeah, we can bring it, sorry. Now we don't need the speakers. It's only this technical detail here. Sorry. Do we have the Zoom return to meeting? And can you see Fionn properly? It's it has been recording all the session. So anybody in the audience can see Fionn? More meeting, go back, participants, start video. There you go. And yeah. But I don't know if I stop and restart, it will just create two videos. I don't know that. It will? Okay. So let me just restart. Ah, okay, here we go. This is the camera. And yeah, but I don't know if people can hear us. There we go. Sorry. This is better. Audio, blah, 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 blah. And now the speaker is off. So. Okay, this is good. And you suggested to stop.